Well, good afternoon. It's August 9th, 2015. I'm Dr. Jack Dempsey, and speaking today with my good friend, Dr. Charles F. Herberger, who in 1972 wrote a book called The Thread of Ariadne, posing that the calendar is central to the organization of Minoan life, and that we can see its organization in a thing called the bull leap fresco. The border of that fresco has an intricate design and pattern, he pointed out in his 1972 book, that fits a lunar solar cycle of 8.5 years. So it's a kind of a major discovery for the roots of Greek calendrics, especially since, well, the people who have discovered the Antikythera mechanism from about 1500 years after the Minoans have no idea, they say themselves, where the roots of its learning came from. So that's probably one among many subjects we'll talk about today. Hello, if I may call you, Chuck.
Yes, indeed.
Say hello loud and clear to the folks at home. Tell us anything you'd like to.
Well, there's not much I can say that has to put into the book, but I think perhaps one thing I should say is this. From the very beginning, I had the idea that the people of Minoan Crete at that time, that early period, as well as other early people, have a tendency to think in a different way from our contemporary concentration on scientific method and a strict rational system we call analysis, with its three basic fundamental laws of logic, which, one of which is based on the law of identity, the law of contradiction, and the law of the excluded middle, the three principles which are so fundamental that the entire structure of mathematics is built on them, as Bertrand Russell and Alfred North Whitehead demonstrated in their work, Principia Mathematica. Now, the difference that I was concerned with, which seemed to be fundamental to the thinking, not only of the Minoans, but of most early people who live in a world that is organized primarily by myth rather than by empirical science, is based upon a different system, which I call synthesis. And the simple matter here is that the fundamental principles involved would be, first of all, analogy. Things are noticed as they're analogous. A spiral shell and a spiral nebulae. Similarity of things is noticed. The kind of analogies are so important. Analogy is one. Then, if you turn to the logical principle of contradiction, you say A is not B. Instead, you find in the synthetic thinking the thought of A is like B. In other words, analogy instead of distinction. And there's also, and this is remarkable and important, the tendency to see polar oppositions as I say, the opposition between up and down. The word up means nothing without the word down. The word east means nothing without the word west, north without south. All these oppositions, which are basic paradoxes, and the people who think synthetically think in those terms. Now we all think synthetically, but without being aware of it. We're not conscious of it, but we do so. But the emphasis upon this among earlier peoples is very strong. The third thing, and this is just as important as the others, is the idea that instead of the logical principle of the excluded middle, where you say A is A and excludes non-A, and it's a thing is itself and it can't be anything else but itself. On the contrary, if in the synthetic thinking, there's not an excluded middle, but an included middle, in the sense that any part is related to the whole, and the whole is related to the part. Or you might say, there are many cases where a microcosm is parallel to a macrocosm. The one reflects the other. And this as a universal in nature.
Well, let me ask you a question just to maybe help to clarify, too. The idea of analogy here for understanding something fundamental about, let's say, how Minoans lived, how they saw nature and organized it, would be that, well, the journey of the sun, it comes out of the darkness, it has a high point in the day, and then it declines into darkness again, only to come around and be reborn. Yeah. This might be considered analogous as it was in Egypt. The journey of the sun is the journey of the soul, the little day of life that is light, flanked by the shadows of darkness from which we come and to which we return. So to see in the Minoan system a understanding of lunar and solar cycles that would be, you might say, the light show, and then to also have that cycle understood to be flanked by Saros eclipse cycles is to have a calendar that includes light and shadow, just like the structure of their architecture. A lot of the symbolism. So, as you say, they're more inclusive. The dark is not a contradiction to the light. It's all part of a cycle. These things are related and dependent on each other for their separate identity, you might say.
Exactly. Then the whole vision of an interrelated world, an interrelated cosmos. Where everything is related to everything else. In other words, the major vision is a version of wholeness. Mm-hmm. In our world, so dominated by science, we divide. Everything is divided. Everything is mechanical. Mm-hmm. Element A hits element B and knocks it into C. This is all linear and made up of mechanical divisions.
And it's in economics, too.
Yes, in all fields.
Yep.
In all fields.
Because it underwrites what we do.
Yes, and of course this is valuable, but it's only half of the truth.
Mm-hmm.
That's the point to my mind. I mean, another point is that this synthetic view of reality is not only the view of mythical thinking, but also of all the arts.
Mm-hmm.
Every artist is a synthesist.
Mm-hmm. And contemporary physics.
exactly.
is the same. There's a whole new frontier of understanding physics that says all these same things.
Modern physics is coming closer and closer, step by step, toward an idea of whole.
Fractal mathematics.
Yes.
Yeah.
Instead of division, look for the whole and see how everything is related to everything else.
In the next segment, I'm going to stop the camera just for a moment. We'll ask you how this appertains more directly to the Minoans of ancient Crete, okay? Think about that. I'll cut that out. So, hello again. Chuck, we've been talking a little bit about the parameters of your discovery in the Thread of Ariadne, 1972. For people who haven't yet read the book, it essentially argues that the pattern in the border of the bull-leap fresco from Knossos bears in its elaborate patterns and anomalies an exact representation of an actual 8.5-year cycle of the sun and the moon, and that this, if anything, would have been the central calendar of the Minoans in a place, Crete, that was using many different calendric systems. So it came to pass that, I think that's 18 years or so after your book, Chuck, a woman named Lucy Goodison from the United Kingdom spent time at Knossos and did photographs of the throne of Knossos, probably the most important central artifact in the Minoan remains, and shows that the seat of Minoan power, whatever that was, aligns with winter solstice day. The sun comes through the doorways and strikes the throne. This seems, more strongly than almost anything, to anchor the idea that the Minoan calendar, the central high one that controlled most of their organization, was anchored at winter solstice day, as you predicted. How does it feel to see a bit of confirmation coming through in your insights, and what more would you like to add to have people think about?
Well, it's simply, I think, simply a strong evidence that the whole structure that's built on this is sound.
Take your time.
I don't know what else to say about that.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, what the picture, you know, is also broader in that in 776 BC, this system, calendric system, which is based on Cretan calendar, the 8.5-year solar lunar cycle, established the 4-year cycle of the Olympic Games, which is simply a half measure of the full 8,
mm-hmm.
and that exists to this day, and that's why the solar torch is carried from one Olympic festival to another.
Mm-hmm.
And the sun, the torch is symbol of the sun.
And to give people a little context around this, I mean, the use of a calendar in those circumstances has a socio-political function. As this is the opinion of scientists published in Nature who are studying the Antikythera mechanism, it's impossible to underestimate the value or to overestimate the value of a calendric system in, well, what we call primitive times, ancient societies. They needed a rhythm of nature to be understood, not only to guide their agriculture, but to arrange a system by which different and fiercely rival polities could get together around athletic events, religious ceremonies, agricultural rites, etc., that would, in a sense, the gentlest sense, force people to get to know each other. This was the original function of what we now call the Olympic Games. So can you talk a little about Minoan kingship? It seems that in the midst of this system, archaeology has striven for probably a century to locate a Minoan king, and they don't seem to be able to do it. Does that have to do with the temporality of power in Minoan Crete related to the calendar? The king or the executive was a sort of a trustee of the office, not a lifelong hereditary ruler, you think, under the calendric system?
Yes, I think so. That's what all the evidence points to. It's fairly, you see, they're really coming out of a matrilinear society, out of a very, as anyone who's done any investigation of early anthropology, early man, has known that the earliest finds are these mother goddesses. Mm-hmm.
And the first clock is the moon.
Yes.
Most people say the first chronometer is the lunar cycle.
Yes, that's right. And the of course, there are so many, like the Venus of Willendorf, there's many of them. There are these voluptuous female figures, which were dominant in the psyche of early man. But then you move on from that, and it's the mother's son, and who, of course, the most of the images we have of a male figure is of a small boy or a young boy, or at least a youth, maybe of mm-hmm. say around anywhere from 18 to 25. You don't see any old bearded men pictured in Minoan art.
In circumstances of political power, unmistakably, such as we do see in Egypt and Syria.
Yeah.
Nothing like that in the Minoan river.
No, you don't. You find various figures of a female goddess or female attendants on a goddess and either a small boy. Mm-hmm. Small boy or a youth.
And it's interesting, though, that the traditions about a King Minos of Crete, even though they come from later, claim to have inherited a good deal of authenticity about Cretan or Minoan customs originally. That is to say, the Minoan King Minos, if he was one, or that was a title of office like Pharaoh, although nothing like that office, which is to say that every 8 years or 9 years, the myths say, and that's why in this cycle we're talking about, which is 8.5, it's both. Minos would have to return to the holy sites of Crete and be re-sanctified or not for continued tenure on the throne. And that's something, the temporality of Cretan political office that continued right through the Dark Age. Malcolm Cross and other really fine scholars have documented these traditions enduring in Crete well after Minoan time, which again is something you'd expect if this pattern of things, the lunar solar cycle and its effects on political order, was actually the case, the daily practice.
Yes, Homer comes along in about the 8th century BC, and Homer says, on Crete, Minos lived, and was king for 9 years, mm-hmm. but they counted the first day and the last. So what they meant by 9 years, we would call 8 years. Mm-hmm.
So we're back. We were talking a little about the connections between the Minoan calendar and not only their agricultural and festival system, but its political implications, its limitations, that is, on, well, the traditional idea of kingship that was later evolved. The Minoans had a very different, and it appears very successful, system for avoiding political entrenchment by people living on the throne. Now, one of the figures that you bring out originally in your research, and that then in my further critical research on that work, a figure that seems to emerge is X. Why this simple, you don't have to be literate to make it, sign? Everywhere from the throne room to pottery to jewelry and to the operations of, well, you might call symbolic objects. That is to say, the cycle of 8.5 years that Professor Herberger discovered is new moon at winter solstice, full moon at summer solstice, 6 months apart. To repeat that, new moon at winter solstice, full moon at summer solstice. 8.5 years later, that exact pair of events repeats. New moon, winter solstice, full moon, summer solstice. A doubled pair of points. We think gathered in the form of an X. Two points on this side, 2 points on that. Now you turn that object around as you would a double X in both a practical and symbolic sense, and it doubles to the same period, the 8.5 years, as the calendar. Right? Now that doubling in turn creates a relationship between the doubled 8.5 year cycle and this Saros or eclipse cycle, which is 18 years and change, flanking the Gregorian cycle with Saros eclipses. The show, you might say, of light and shadow, the interplay of these. It seems to me striking all the way through these evidences that that little figure X continues to appear. Not only that, but you were the one to see it first in the rectangle of the Minoan border, that by counting along this calendar season and year by season and year, it every 2 years forms an X in the middle. We find that same X in the throne room. That is to say, the light comes in on winter solstice, touches the throne. It comes in on summer solstice and touches another important part of the throne chamber. Anything to say about why this form is so persistent and the way that it may relate to our cycle?
This is a fascinating point, because long after I had written my book, I came across something very, very interesting from a place quite unexpected. In South America, there's a tribe that has been investigated by an anthropologist, and he discovered that they have a whole system of thought, which lies behind their entire culture, and it's based upon a loom. It's a loom which they can weave cloth, but it's got this cross, mm-hmm. and it's in a frame, and they believe that the mother goddess taught them how to use the cloth to the frame to make cloth, but they're not only making cloth, they're making the very threads of life, and this symbol for them specifically relates to solar movement. So the point up here in this corner would be the point of the of the summer solstice, mm-hmm. sunrise, the point over here of the summer solstice sunset, the point down here of the winter solstice sunrise, point here of the winter solstice sunset.
That's exactly what we're talking about.
Yeah, and the cross, of course, at the point in the middle, a horizontal line would be the equinox. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, the thing is, I saw this explained as something that lay behind the thinking and the whole culture of the South American tribe, and of course they'd come upon it by observing, but the shape of the thing struck me. This looks just like a double axe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the visual pun between X itself as a figure of writing,
right.
and the blades of a double axe.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. So I began to look around, and I found, to my great surprise, that this figure could be found in many cultures all over the world. Mm-hmm. And so that, for instance, there is a...
Which is not to say necessarily the Minoans were in touch with them, but rather that this is an observation, representing the sun.
They found it independently.
It's quite common.
But the amazing thing is, I found an example of this carved on a stone in northern New England, mm-hmm. Close to the Canadian border, I found it in the hieroglyphs of the Minoan culture. Mm-hmm. Their hieroglyph for sun and year is the same thing. It's a cross within a rectangle,
mm-hmm.
and it means sun.
And it can also be in a circle. The X within a circle is what?
Exactly.
Again, those double pairs of points that are a cycle.
Yes.
That repeat. It's.
And then I found it at New Grange in Ireland, the great New Grange chamber tomb.
Mm-hmm.
Has a window box up over the main entrance,
mm-hmm.
which it was discovered that the winter solstice sunrise came through that window and struck mm-hmm. the opposite wall of the tunnel.
Mm-hmm.
So it had a solar implication. But the most important thing is that there's a band on the top of that box, and it's made up of eight successive
X's.
Mm-hmm. And so it would be parallel to the 8-year cycle.
Mm-hmm. So it goes to say that, I mean, if all these other cultures have represented a similar solar cycle in these ways, why couldn't the Minoans have meant the same thing by this sign? But it also has even more connections across their works of art, right down to the Philistine times. It really does. To come back to Greece for a second, too, on this, you may be aware, I think in the last little piece we were talking about Homer a bit, and there's a pair of scholars, Ken and Florence Wood, who have published a book called Secrets of Homer, perhaps. It's on our website, anyway. And they have shown, episode by episode, in the Iliad-Odyssey poems, that the 19-year cycle we've mentioned as flanking the 8.5-year cycle, doubled, is exactly the period of time, the, quote, 20 years, that Odysseus has been wandering. So again, from the Minoan times all the way down through Homeric times, we have artistic and political repetitions of this period of time that would seem to be, well, just what you'd expect if the original system really was that central and everywhere practiced.
Yes.
Lots of other confirmations coming in, Professor.
I found the same symbol again in the Agora at Athens. It was on a ceramic burial urn.
And their word for the cycle is octateres, right?
Yeah,
the 8-year cycle? Go ahead.
That's right. I found it, and this is even more surprising. I found this symbol on an icon that represented Odysseus in the cave of the Cyclops,
mm-hmm.
and carrying a staff with the X
engraved on it,
X pattern,
yep.
on a line,
mm-hmm.
and there are 12 of them. We told that he had 12
companions
yeah. in the cave, and this is a sort of almost like an emblem of what he's doing there.
12 eights are 96.
Yeah.
A certain number of moons that stretches over that 8-year cycle, right?
Right. And I found it also much, much earlier at Camel Hayuk.
Katahayuk.
Yeah.
Yes.
That goes back to about 6,000 BC.
Yeah, one of the oldest urban environments there is.
And there, it's on a shrine, on the wall of a shrine.
Yeah.
And it's lined up so that it's north. It's directly north. So the symbol is there, and it's perfectly lined up to the north. We know also that this building where it's on the wall of which it is a shrine, according to the archaeologists who excavated it.
Mm-hmm.
So here you have it back that early.
Mm-hmm. All right, let's pause just for a moment.
Yes.
Get our breath, and I'll make a smaller file on this. Don't worry, I'm not going to. I think so. So, Professor Herberger, I'm wondering if some of the people who either have looked a little bit, at least, at your work in the Thread of Ariadne about the bull-leap fresco, its calendar, the Minoan great year cycle, and the different implications of that, I'm wondering if people who've either read it or not seen it at all yet are wondering why there hasn't been more recognition given the accreting evidence of this. Hey, pun intended, accreting, right? But given the accretion of evidence, the fact that there is, in a sense, no comparable body of Minoan evidence you can gather that would show a completely different central system to their calendar. What, in your feeling, are the obstacles to that? Are there problems you feel are not resolved for people? What would you most like them to know in order to say, well, you should give it a shot anyway, you should take it seriously and check it out for yourself?
Yes, well, certain things strike me. First of all, no one knowledgeable claims that the Minoans did not have a calendar. They all admit they have a calendar.
That kind of organization, you have to, right?
But what kind of a calendar, they are not in any agreement about. And we have provided, you and I, you've done a lot of extraction, have made it very clear what a calendar is evidenced by the palace, the fresco, and its fresco correspondence with the solar lunar system, so clearly that what can the authorities claim? They say we have a calendar, but we don't know what it was. We say you have a calendar, and we know what it was. And we have, I think, given strong evidence that this is consistent step by step with what you see in the Knossos fresco. So, why is it not accepted? Well, new ideas are always very difficult to introduce, especially if you're, as I am, not an archaeologist. There's usually a feeling of, rightly so, of course, that archaeologists have been trained specifically in that discipline, and I have not. So, when someone from my area comes into their territory, naturally they're very skeptical, and they should be skeptical. But I think that if you give a truly open-minded audience to the evidence that we have presented, you and I, mm-hmm. they'll have to come around eventually to accepting it.
I think it should be said too that while everything that you said I basically agree with in my own professional experience, there is nothing in either of these works that is inconsistent with the findings of these archaeologists. In other words, we're not disputing where something was found or what it looked like or what its possible practical and other functions were, but rather we're looking at the conclusions they themselves reach about these objects and noticing connections, noticing, as you mentioned earlier, the analogous forms, the similarities and connections and repeated patterns that would seem to indicate the daily and centrally official use of a calendric cycle like this. We are not, again, contradicting or hiding anything about any of the evidences whatsoever, but there are so many formal residences among the pieces. The throne, the X form, the double axe, many others.
Well, it's just a matter of hermeneutics.
Explain.
Hermeneutics is the discipline of interpreting symbols. And this is why I have quite naturally fallen into this area, because as a professor of literature, my principal job as a teacher was interpretation of literature, which is hermeneutics, interpreting symbols. So it was in the basis of that that I got into interpreting the calendar. And again, it's a whole system of consistent evidences all falling together suddenly in one unit, mm-hmm. as a whole. Mm-hmm.
Having said that, you know, it comes probably a little bit ironically or painfully ironic, but one of the very few comments I got from, you could say, the population at large for some of the postings that are put out there to try to make these things known was, the person felt, without explaining, that it was arbitrary for us to argue that the Minoans would put their calendar into a wall fresco. I don't understand that remark in the sense that, well, what else could we have expected them to use? They wouldn't have put it on a single vase. They wouldn't have made it illegibly small on a ring or a piece of jewelry. They needed a canvas on which to put this anatomy of the lunar solar cycle. Overall, though, the level of engagement so far has been difficult to initiate, you might say. And yet this is a field, as people know, that was founded by an amateur, Arthur Evans, a lot of whose findings have survived a lot of criticism, too. Wasn't always right, but
a lot of
amateurs have contributed here, right?
Because the linear B was discovered by a non specialist.
Deciphered, you mean?
Yes.
Yes, exactly. Michael Ventris.
Michael Ventris, exactly. So, while we people who are non-archaeologists must acknowledge our limitations, we have our particular areas of strength. And I think we can stand right on that.